And I didn't know a whole lot about them other than that my friend was a big supporter. So I go and I go to our other friends are there, and it's mostly PTA moms, and we're, you know, sitting around talking and getting together. And these are women I've known at this point for 10 years. Our kids have grown up together, they go to school together, our husbands hang out, we travel together. So I feel really comfortable with this group of ladies. And we're standing around talking, and one by one, my friends start sharing these deeply, deeply personal, but very similar stories. And I was so shocked because it wasn't what they were saying, it was that they had never felt like they had told me before. And I'm going to talk a little bit more about that later, but it was those conversations that profoundly influenced my understanding of the difference between sympathy and empathy, which is what I want to talk about today. Looking at the differences between sympathy and empathy, I was trying to come up with a really good way to describe it, because empathy kind of has a few different definitions, and I want to make sure we're all thinking the same thing. So I have a short video by Brene Brown. You probably have seen the video, you may be familiar with her work. She gave a TED Talk a few years ago in Texas that went viral. But it's a really succinct and equally cute way to describe it. So.
So what is empathy, and why is it very different than sympathy? Empathy fuels connection. Sympathy drives disconnection. Empathy, it's very interesting. Teresa Wiseman is a nursing scholar who studied professions, very diverse professions, where empathy is relevant, and came up with four qualities of empathy. Perspective taking, the ability to take the perspective of another person, or recognize their perspective as their truth. Staying out of judgment, not easy when you enjoy it as much as most of us do. Recognizing emotion in other people and then communicating that. Empathy is feeling with people. And to me, I always think of empathy as this kind of sacred space where someone's kind of in a deep hole and they shout out from the bottom and they say, I'm stuck, it's dark, I'm overwhelmed. And then we look and we say, hey, I'm down. I know what it's like down here, and you're not alone. Sympathy is, ooh, it's bad, huh? No, you want a sandwich? Empathy is a choice, and it's a vulnerable choice, because in order to connect with you, I have to connect with something in myself that knows that feeling. Rarely, if ever, does an empathic response begin with at least. And we do it all the time. Because you know what? Someone just shared something with us that's incredibly painful, and we're trying to silver lining it. I don't think that's a verb, but I'm using it as one. We're trying to put the silver lining around it. So, I had a miscarriage. At least you know you can get pregnant. I think my marriage is falling apart. At least you have a marriage. John's getting kicked out of school. At least Sarah is an A student. But one of the things we do sometimes in the face of very difficult conversations is we try to make things better. If I share something with you that's very difficult, I'd rather you say, I don't even know what to say right now, I'm just so glad you told me. Because the truth is, rarely can a response make something better. What makes something better is connection.
Like this, right? You said cards like this. this is, that's nice, not necessarily helpful. When a friend or a neighbor or a coworker has some kind of trauma, they've lost a child, they are going through a divorce, they're going bankrupt, sending this means I don't have to engage in your pain. So it keeps you safe. It lets you think you're doing something without actually having to do something. And we do this a lot. And that's because empathy on the other hand is hard. This means you have to feel something with someone. That means you have to feel sadness and heartache and loss and disappointment. This is a failure and loneliness. And that's hard. So when you send this, you're saying, I promise not to be silver lining of this. And it requires a certain honesty that you have to have even with yourself. So that honesty and vulnerability, that's what brings us together. That's empathy. So if empathy is so hard, why can't we just be sympathetic and call it a day? Connection feeds a meaningful existence. As humans, we need that connection. So loving someone and being loved, caring for someone and being cared for. I lost my voice. Having someone share your pain and sharing theirs, taking that risk makes us better friends, better parents, better neighbors, and better people. So quick question, social media, more or less connected? Who says we're more connected? Who says less? Here's my argument for more. Social media offers us opportunities to connect in a way that we wouldn't because we never met these people otherwise. So I see on Facebook that we're both breast cancer survivors. That automatically makes me get closer to you, and I have that connection. On the other hand, social media isn't designed for an empathic response. All of the tools available are sympathetic and hollow. And so when we're on social media and someone is clearly reaching out for a real connection, it's so much easier to do this than this. So back to our first question, why do we need empathy? Why can't we just be sympathetic? Well, so we know from a personal standpoint, our lives are better because of it. But we also need it on a global scale. Connection is needed for a peaceful society. So we live in this world with all kinds of religious, ethnic, social differences. And in order to bridge that gap, we have to start to feel what it feels like to be somebody else, somebody who's completely different. The other one is self-preservation. This is a little bit different. This applies to all of us, but I think particularly about nurses and people who work in a helping profession. If they were truly empathetic with every client and every patient, feeling that weight would be crushing. So they have to separate that out, and they can offer sympathy and offer help and be caring without having the full emotional investment that you would have with a dear friend or a neighbor or somebody. So, when we're looking at empathy and sympathy, we have to ask ourselves, is it self-preservation or self-protection? And you have to be really honest if you want to answer that question. So this is where I think this starts to get really interesting, because we have this thing called the empathy altruism hypothesis, which is pretty much exactly what it sounds like. I'm going to define altruism really quickly, though, because I think there's a really broad way to describe it. But for our purposes, it's an action that helps another regardless of the benefit to oneself. And so the empathy altruism hypothesis basically says empathic concern produces altruistic motivation. That's the call to action. Because when I feel your pain, I want to do something. I want to do something to help. I want to do something to fix. So if I was just sympathetic, I wouldn't have that same connection, that same drive. So, what is empathy in action, and why does a creative approach matter? Well, it might not. The reason I think it does is because approaching something through art has the advantage of being disarming. It changes the narrative, and it can change the perspective. So we have this advantage for, you know, anybody who works in a creative field or considers themselves creative or has a brain. We have these opportunities to creatively approach this.
I'm going to show some examples.
There are so many things going on all over this country, let alone the world. So it was difficult to pick. These were literally like top view came across my desk. This is the Combat Fever Project in San Francisco, California. And what they do is they work with veterans, and they literally deconstruct their clothes, their uniforms from war, and turn it into paper. And then paper becomes art. And it's this process of sort of renewal, of healing. It gives them an opportunity to tell their story and to educate people about what their experience was like. This one I love. So the Light of Human Kindness in Richmond, Virginia. I pick on mural projects a lot, and I'll show you why in a minute. This is a great example of an empathetic mural. So the first thing they did was engage the community. The community came, and they got to tell their story and put their words on the wall. Then they had an artist come in and begin to paint parts of the mural over it. And the idea was to obscure the text enough that you're not reading it as text, but you view it as text. It also was an opportunity to sort of bind these stories together, and they all became one piece. But then they went further, and they incorporated technology. And so, now people can go and perform an act of kindness anywhere in the world, upload their experience online, and parts of the wall will light up in real time. So the person on the end of the computer and the person at the wall are both sharing this experience without really even knowing each other. And it's powerful.
It's a lot more powerful
than this. This, to me, is a sympathetic mural. We come into your community, we paint something pretty, and we leave. There's no impact, there's no change, there's no engagement, there's no vulnerability. This is another engagement project. So, Tier City Community Art Center Gardner, Massachusetts was a furniture manufacturing town for a long time. And when manufacturing left, the town didn't just lose jobs, they lost their identity. And it echoes a lot of what happened in Cleveland, and we see it in our town all the time. And so Tracy is doing a combined oral history, printmaking, and bookbinding project. And what's so exciting about what she's doing is that it's completely interactive. She's right in a storefront in the middle of town, which is not only highly visible, but it offers this sort of idea of hope and renewal as they're building something new. The rest of the storefronts are all vacant. It's a place where people can go. Everybody is welcome. It gives the people in the town the chance to tell their story, gives them a voice. While they're sitting there telling and writing their stories and finding these books, they're sharing experiences, so it fosters community. And she didn't just come into town and do this project in a week. She's invested, she's there, and she's working directly with the community to support them. This is one of my favorite examples. Visual aids. If anybody hasn't heard this story, 99% Invisible is a podcast. Well, they have a story about this, and it's really, really great. But for anyone who remembers the 80s and early 90s, AIDS was terrifying, and it was absolutely not talked about. It was the gay plague, and nobody wanted to touch it. And people were dying. So this group of artists in 1991 literally just got together and started cutting ribbons. They were looking for a way to make AIDS visible, to force it into the public discussion. And from that, we fast forward 25 years, and the stigma of AIDS in the United States is almost none. And recognition of the Red Ribbon as AIDS awareness is all over the world. So a few artists wanted to support people and wanted to get together and have a visual representation, and it became this movement. The last project is mine. We did this last year, and so we were watching as the Black Lives Movement was gaining momentum. You know, we were doing all the sort of sympathetic things you do, and you're not really sure what to do for somebody. We were writing checks, and we got a bumper sticker, and we were sharing things on Facebook, but it was hollow, and we were really looking to do something. And I wasn't really sure what my place was in this conversation. So, I mean, this is self-protection, not self-preservation, right? This is about fear of saying the wrong thing and doing the wrong thing. So the safe thing to do would have been to stay sympathetic, to just keep the bumper sticker and the donation and call it a day. But there was no depth to that, and this felt too important to stand on the sidelines for. And I didn't know what I was going to do, but we started thinking about ideas. First place I went was, I'm a printmaker, so that's where we started. When the March on Washington was announced, when the March on Washington in the fall was announced, we thought it was a great opportunity, and so we took a long time thinking about the design and what we wanted to say and what would complement the voices that were out there already. And this is what we came up with. And we printed 500 and drove them down to Washington, and as soon as we got there, I got scared again. And we pulled into the hotel, and I had this incredibly heavy, ridiculously heavy box of posters. And I just thought, what if nobody wants them? What if people say, you know, we don't want your white suburban poster, but thanks. But we were down there, and this is what we intended to do, so we went out and did it. And, you know, there may have been plenty of people who felt like, keep your poster, I don't want it. But in the mile between the hotel and the start of the march, we found 400 496 people who wanted it. So we didn't go there because we thought we were going to solve anything. We didn't go to feel good about ourselves. We went to help people amplify their voices. We wanted to acknowledge their lived experience without judgment. And we wanted to stand in solidarity and say, yeah, you know what, you're right. This isn't fair. This shouldn't be happening. And I'm going to be here with you. That's empathy. So if I go back to the very beginning, when I was telling you the story about my friends, I went to this fundraiser with my friends, and I realized that in spite of all of the personal, deeply personal stories that we've been sharing over the years, breastfeeding, financial problems, affairs, divorce, that they had never felt like they could tell me about their abortion until then. And that was when I chose empathy. Thank you.